If you can take yourself right to the edge of the cliff and you're about and 1 foot off and you're holding on, and that's financially, mentally, anyone, even the family, if you can take everyone to the edge or anything to the edge with you and you still believe that you can do it, then you made it. But if you're the type of person that doesn't have the balls, blood, that's all this is about. Do you have the balls? Are you ready to put them on a chopping board and the knife might or might not? Do you understand? That's what I learned about being Steel Banglez and an entrepreneur and my dreams and everything. Do you have the balls and can you risk it all? Are you ready to die for this? And that's the kind of mentality I have. My name's Steel Banglez. I'm from East London and I'm a music producer, songwriter, DJ and visionary and a label owner. I was most probably in my mum's womb when my mum started playing music to me because she's a musician. So I must be started from birth. But when I was conscious enough to know that I was on the planet, then yeah, that's when I started music. It's like 3-4 years old. I don't think age has anything to do with anything creative, do you know what I mean? I just think that's man-made, that's just something else. Time and effort is a factor. How much do you spend on your craft? That's is the main factor, not age. How much time do you put on it and how regularly do you do it? That's it. I grew up in East London in a Sikh household. My dad was a poet. My mum's a music teacher. We claimed asylum in this country, or whilst the process was going on of claiming asylum, my mum obviously stopped doing music and she got a job to support the family. And then there would be like, when my parents came to this country, they came with loads of instruments and stuff. So we were very poor growing up, very poor actually. All we really had to play with was like Indian instruments. So that was my entertainment. We didn't even have a TV. That's how poor we were. We lived in a house with three other families in East Ham. It was one family to each room, and I remember we shared the bathroom and the kitchen, and that was up until I was 8 years old, 9 years old. Totally broke, crazy. And all we had was like tambourines, a couple like Indian drums, and a harmonium. And that was our form of entertainment. And my mum would sing to us at night and stuff when she'd get back from work. And then there was like four of us siblings in one room. So all we ever used to do was just music. So that's how my journey began, with my mum conditioning us from young, watching my older brothers progress more than me, learning from them. Then eventually we got, the council gave us a house in Forest Gate. My brothers bought some decks. He started working in Tesco. Then he started DJing. I was about 11 years old, 10 years old in this, the drum and bass era. And I started like taking in new sounds apart from Indian music. You know, like my parents wouldn't, because they're not from here, they wouldn't really expose us to the sounds here, unless I heard it in school or something. But it was still very minimal and we still didn't have a TV yet. So yeah, we had decks though and a speaker system. But yeah. So yeah, I started watching my older brothers DJing and stuff like that and all this crazy stuff. And then I got old enough to go out, and then I started discovering my friends, and they would play like garage, and grime was nearly on the brink of coming out through UK garage. So I lived through the UK garage era, but I never really used to get into the clubs because I was too young. So I would, when my brother goes out, I'd then jump on a mix because he went from jungle to garage. Then I'd mix garage and I was whack them days, like I wasn't that good as a DJ. But sonically started training my ears. You know, I started MCing, my friends, we all got in a crew as you do when you're young. You know, one's a DJ, one's an MC, I ended up being the DJ. My brother was in his crew, so I was just trying to copy him, make my own little crew or whatever. You know, just in the end, started making some noise, and then about like 13, 14, I picked up Fruity Loops. I started producing my own tunes. I passed my GCSE music in year 9. I A-starred it 2 years early. And I kind of derailed off school then because I thought, well, I've done my music. That's all I ever wanted to do. So forget school. So I started like not turning up to year 10, messing that whole year 10 up. During that time, I met DEE, who's from Forest Gate. He's one of like the greatest grime MCs of all time for me. And he started like, being a fan of him and then getting to know him gave me an insight to the music industry of what was about to happen in the UK. And that's why I say I'm a visionary at the start, because I knew that this is an English speaking country and whatever that was going on in America is about to happen here. I don't know how long it's going to take to happen here, but I need to be a part of this.
Yo, Ooh.
Louis White, bigger.
Instrumental.
It's me.
D-double.
On the vocal.
Ooh. Colours.
So that's the journey up until like 16. Started chilling with D-double, met all these crews, rolled deep, went vinyl shopping since young. It's a very long thing to say. So up until 16, that's what I did. 16, 17, I went to prison. I got 6 years and I'd done 3 years straight. And whilst I was incarcerated, I met a lot of people from South London and they were doing rap. And I've just come in from like hearing grime going off outside in East London to now coming to South London and hearing the early Blade Brown SMS PDC kind of tapes on tape. We was listening to them getting sent in. And whilst I was incarcerated, a year in, I got a keyboard in my prison cell. Something like this, but where you can record it on like six tracks, like drum patterns and stuff. So I would make beats in my cell, and then I met Colors Miyagi, and I met Fix Dot, and I met Young Meth, who all got out of prison before me and started blowing up. When I came out, I started hearing about them. Pain Is The Essence came out, Gigs and Dubs. Like, someone played me that. I remember a guy, he was from Liverpool, but he had home leave, I remember. I forgot his name, man. But like that even sparked so much energy in my head. Like, whoa, I was just, it was like this anticipation of coming out of prison and getting back into the music. So hearing loads of new music and seeing what was going on was crazy. Anyway, I got released and then like my first month, 2 months, I just stayed in my room. My cousin lent me his PC because I was broke. He gave me this like server PC, so it was a bit mashed up and that. Like, I just had to do what I had. I started making a few beats and a couple months in, I made like 4 tunes and I sent them to Youngster at the time, Young Meth. He vocaled them. They ended up being on a mixtape with Fix Dot and Fix of Meth. That's the Ruthless Record days in East Ham with Ratty. And we pressed the CDs out and Giggs' thing was going off then. And then Fix Dot was part of OTB, which was Buck, who's Giggs' manager. And it started going into circles. My name started spreading around with that industry, that, like, that scene. But it was super early. It was like a seed in the plant pot. Like, it was so early of UK rap. So my first mixtape comes out and it's a massive success on the streets. The beats go down well because I knew about producing before I went to prison and I had that little edge over the new rap producers in UK rap. So I had bits, different type of quality. Not the mixing weren't that great, but it just, I think it was experience. Remember going back to his age, in fact, I know it's time and experience and how much you put into your craft. So I had a bit more knowledge in rap than times. So yeah, my beats are a hit on the streets. I start getting hollered by other rappers. You know, the music spreads out, Giggs follows me, he hits me up. Like, I've started to get recognition, but he followed me at that time. Like, yo, your beats are crazy. I was like, thank you. And then it sparks a competition. And I see all the other producers that are doing their thing with all these rappers. And I'm on mode now. I'm like, okay, so, you know, I can hear my name being mentioned by Michael Million and all these early days of rap and other people are hollering me, you know. So it was good. It was that MSN and Facebook days. Blade Brown hollers at me from that mixtape. I send Blade Brown a beat and he does it with B-Double, and that was my first video, which was called SWAT. That video comes out, it's a mad hit. B-Double's big at the time, he's from Tottenham. Blade is massive. And yeah, it just, like, my name keeps growing and growing and growing, and I finally get to a point where I got my own studio. One of my best friends, Roper, builds a studio in his house for me, and I just start working out of his house. And then I start working with Getz, Dot Rotten, who's a producer I work with now. That was in 2009. I started working with Wiley, and then through Young Meth and Fix Dot, I meet my first proper project, which is Cashtastic. So I meet Cashtastic, and I start working with him. He's got a nice buzz. He's from Peckham. He's doing his thing. Girls like him. He's making great music. So I start. We start developing a more producer-artist relationship, less than doing sessions. So now I can start to create a sound for him. In the mix of that, I do a song with P-Money, Big H, Wiley and Getz called Breakdown, which is my first Steel Banglez featuring song. That's back in 2009. That song comes out. It goes on Lord of the Mics. I can't remember, 2, 3 or something. I can't remember what one it was. I remember Jamma coming to the studio and being like, look, man, we want to sign this song to Lord of the Mics. There's a little P. Took my little money, whatever, gave them the song. The song goes big because all the MCs at the time have got beef. Cashtastic starts blowing up. He does a Link Up TV champion freestyle, it goes mad.
I live life my way. My auntie got shot Thursday. Then my uncle died on the Friday. This is real talk, I ain't even gotta lie, mate. I'm immune to death nowadays, I don't cry, mate.
Me, seeing Cash put out tunes. And at the same time, my name starts getting big, and then I do stuff with Mashtown, with Margs. So I start doing all this work with Margs, and then through Margs, I meet Benny Banks and Joe Black. I do work with them. So I'm just doing loads and loads of work with whatever's going on in that rap scene right now. And I'm just, my studio's like kind of like the main hub, but at the time I couldn't see it, but everyone's passing through my studio, it's crazy. And I'm just full of energy, and I'm just making loads of tunes, loads of tunes, loads of tunes. Then I do Margs' project. Margs on a hype thing, that comes out, Kills the Streets. I've got everyone on there, Kreps on there, Getz is on there, Giggs is on there, Spades is on there. Like, I've done the whole mixtape. It gives me my first solid work. Before that, actually, I done Petrelli Diaries for Fix.em. That's another mixtape that does well. And we're still in this mixtape era. And then me and Cashtastic make a banger. The studio that I'm in at my friend's house, he's currently going through a lot of situations, so I have to move all my studio equipment out of there. And I was kind of like stuck, so I'm like, whoa, like, I've come all the way here, my name's buzzing, and my brethren's going through a lot, I have to move all my equipment out. I remember the girl that I was with at the time, she came and picked up all my stuff from the studio, and I was just like proper heartbroken, driving all the way back to Forest Gate in my house, to my house, and put on like going back to my bedroom after I've had two studios. I'm thinking, damn. So then my brethren comes, and he's like, convinces my mum to lend me $4,000. I know my mum didn't even have that money. So I don't know how it happened, but my brother got involved or something, my oldest brother. And then, you know, I get $4,000, and then I find this unit in Royal Victoria called Waterfront Studios, where now Link Up TV's there in that building. So I find a studio right at the end of this corridor where there's loads of like businesses, and then I do like build the studio up. I do a room with him within a room theory. At the same time as that's going on, Cashtastic is still with me every day. He's like my artist, and he's writing, I'm producing, and we're just getting what now is a little bit of Cash ready, the mixtape. Studio gets done. I didn't even finish it. I was just too eager to get in, and we do that. I finish a little bit of Cash, and Krypton and Conan come into the picture. I start working with them. I done Let Go for them with Lewis Watson. That does really well on a radio tip. Then this controversy with Chip starts, and then they end up doing a song, and it's called Go Down South, which I put my tag on, which was taken out. So people would have known who Steel Banglez is then, but my tag was taken out. Money going up, girls going down. Inside you out. Know me now, bet you know me now. I don't care where you're from, just use your brain. Heads up, go down south. And Cashtastic starts blowing up, Krypton Conan start blowing up, and then Younglin comes into the picture through the Stay Scheming bit. The Stay Scheming song comes out, I'm in the video, Cash mentions me. Me and Bangles in that E-class, hashtag winning. Boosts my name more, start working with Younglin more, we drop Off The Record, which smashes it, everyone loves that beat. That goes on SBTV featuring Ari. Cashtastic drops Marching, I drop other tunes with him, he drops other tunes with other producers, we're all building. Krypton Conan are doing stuff with Rhymes here, everyone's just active, everything's just going crazy. Wiley's coming into the studio, I do Only Human with him and Cashtastic. That comes out, it's my first signing, my first paycheck from music. Evolve or Be Extinct was the album. So I'm carrying on producing, working on Cash's next project, which is Alarm Clock, working on Younglin's first mixtape, which I'd done about 7 songs on. And it's just going, going, going. My name's getting bigger. I still haven't put my tag in because I just felt like people, I don't want to say no names, but people that I was working with, or people that were around the people that were working with, or people that were just around me were like, why are you trying to be out there like that? Like, and I'm just like, blood, this is my dream. Like, don't you know what I'm on? Like, I've had this dream. Like, people would say I'm Khaled, or people would say I'm Metro. I had my tag time before any of these tags were even about. I was doing it. Do you know what I'm trying to say? I learned that from DJ Premier. Do you know what I'm trying to say? All these comparisons, all these copies, but that's just the new fans. But anyway, yes, yeah, so I had this thing where I knew to be a top producer, you have to get your name out there. And I learned that from Dre and Timbaland. I learned that from time ago. So I'm just trying to get my name out there so I can make a bit of money. Like, I'm just looking at everyone like, you lot are all making dough. You lot are getting on stuff. And I need a tune. And then me and Cashtastic have like a little mini argument. And I'm like, blood, you need to give me a song, because I've done so much for you. And he's like, well, why are you trying to? And then he gives me a song, and then I release Wafy. And it features Margs. Margs is hot at the time. Cashtastic's hot at the time. I've dropped the beat and yeah, it goes crazy. I get playlisted on Choice, which is now known as Capital Extra. I was on Choice FM, Jenny Francis is on there every evening. She's banging out Wafy. Everyone's talking about it. It's doing well for that time. It keeps going, keeps growing. And then the studio that I was in, I think someone else now has come into the picture and had and have got a studio there as well. But they're misbehaving. So it's made a negative impact on the people that own the building that do they want studios in there. So then people get kicked out and then like a month and a half later, they just come like saying, Banglez, I'm sorry, man, but this studio stuff is not allowed. Like we're not keeping studios in here anymore. So I lose my third studio now. So I'm just like, what am I gonna do? Luckily enough for me, with some of the money that I saved, me and my brothers, we got together and we moved our parents out of Forest Gate and we bought our first house. The garden was big enough, but anyway, I've got some money saved and I come home after being kicked out with all my equipment, put it in the shed. And I'm thinking, what am I going to do? And I go into the garden just because I just wanted to sit in the garden. And I just look at the garden and I'm like, this is a massive garden. I might as well just put my studio here. And then I phoned my bedroom AJ up. I had like £2,000, I think, not much money. And I'm like, AJ, listen, I need 15 grand. Like, I need to borrow it. And then he lends me the money. I start building the studio. I build this room. Cashtastic moves back in. Youngun keeps coming down. Crept and Conan come down. I do work. Crept and Conan kind of blow up and do their thing. I haven't seen them since, kind of. In that way, in that musical relationship's kind of dead. Youngun comes to check me and Cash. Then Cashtastic gets removed, so then I take another blow. I'm working on Cashtastic, he's signed to Universal. I'm thinking this is my way in to what I want to do. Let me be that guy that supports this person first. He gets removed from the UK for some immigration issues, I don't know, whatever. Because I've been through so many L's, and I'm just like, that just gives me into next spiral of depression, and I just end up depressed. So I've got this brand new studio in the back of my house, and like, I'm just thinking like, what am I gonna do? People that used to check in for me, that I might have contributed to their success, or just not looking out for me, which you shouldn't expect anything from anyone anyway. If you give, you just do your thing, whatever. But I'm just like, whoa, I need something. Like, people know that Cashtastic has been, they know Banglez and Cash are like this. Like, they, you know, Cashtastic's been removed. The only person that's checking on me is Zeph, aka Dot Rotten at the time. A couple of my other brethren from Gate and Youngun from the industry. I get calls from other people from the industry, but it's dead talk. And then I just come up with like, what am I gonna do? I get this whiteboard in my studio and I start to write out, well, I think I've got a pretty big name or like a big enough name to like maybe speak to people about giving features to me. So like I put all these lists of what people I would want on my project, and I'm like now focusing on building my brand. And I'm reaching out to people, and Sneakbo and Youngun come through, they do a song for me, they're cool, they do it for me. I'm like, cool, thank you. Jay Spades comes through, does a hook for me. I got this song sitting there with like the biggest rappers of that moment, and a few of the rappers on there are stopping me from putting that song out. Like I would have had the biggest collab at that time in UK rap, but you know, labels and all this stuff just stopped me from putting out the song. The song was crazy. It had like Jay Spades, Youngun, Squeaks, Cashtastic, Ard Ad, Show Shallow, Sneakbo, Crept and Conan. It was mad, and like it was just political to get the song out. So I still got that song sitting there, but that could have been like a song that changed my career. That something could have, you know, people could have done something for me. So I went through the stress of that, couldn't put out that record. So like my career's going through like madness right now. Like I'm just fucked, you know what I'm saying? I'm at home, my mum's screwing at me. She's seen me do music from when I come out of prison, never got a job, to now I'm 6-7 years in. Ain't got fuck all to show for it, to be honest. But I'm just like, don't worry, what is coming? Like I've still got the faith, but when I don't speak to anyone, I'm more like, fuck, in my head. Like I'm just watching the game and I'm just watching loads of music come out and my shit's not going well. So I'm just like, linking Zef, linking Savak, producing or whatever. Ropes coming to see me here and there. And I'm just like lost in my house, man. I'm just fucked. Going through this mad depression, man. 2 years into my depression, I hear Nobody by Mo Stack.
So I trust nobody. Nobody heard them niggas wanna roll on me. Roll on me.
And I'm like, yo, this kid is gonna blow. So like I get onto Twitter and I message him and I'm like, bro, I need to work with you because you're special and I know what to do. Like we need to work together. I know where you are, I know what position you're in, I know what's about to happen, like we need to be around each other. So I caught him very, very early and then I linked him. He came to the studio and we instantly clicked. He was grateful for being out of the hood, having a regular studio to go to because he was paying studio time elsewhere. That was always my thing. I always made people have their own home at my studio. I'd always let you cook in my kitchen. It was never about me. I was just happy seeing you cook in my kitchen. I'm that kind of guy. I'm just happy to have a plate, you know, one of them ones, even though it's my kitchen. Boom, Mostak's doing his thing, I'm supporting him, we're doing his mixtape. Savak's working on it with me, Zeph's worked on it with me. All of us are just there, just working. It comes out, it does its thing, and then 2015, New Year's Eve, going into 2016, an artist from Leicester that I've worked with previously called Maru comes down to spend New Year's Eve with me. He's with me and my brother Beaks, aka Dirty Money, and he plays me Mist for the first time. And then I hear Mist and I'm like, I'm coming out of this, like, I'm finding that momentum again. I'm like, fuck yes, this is gonna happen. I'm realizing the third generation of UK rap is kicking in. It's got a bit more Afro vibey. It's a bit more not like the Cash and Krypton Conan. I consider them second generation, younger than that. This more Mostacky and this little thing's going on is the next generation down. And I start to notice the same pattern that Cash and all of these men used to have with the fans going crazy, the 14 to 16 year olds. And I start to see everything that I've learned before happen again. And I'm just getting super excited about it. And I'm just like, all I've got is faith. I'm broke, I'm fucked, I'm done. Like, my mum's asking me for £300 for the bills. My brother's like, get a job. My brethren's even convincing me, like, you should work a couple of days a week. And I'm just adamant, I'm just stubborn. I'm like, no, that's all I want to do, music or just kill me. So I'm just going in and I'm just most that thing's popping off. And then I hear Mist. And I'm just like, this is it. I hear him say Asian words and I'm just like, blood, he's cracked it. He's the first guy in the country to incorporate Asian words with, and how many Asians are in this country? It's like the Mexicans in America. Like, no one's done it.
Mist, P110, one take. Also, all my fucking dogs. My art miles and my fucking car lights. Shadow on the beat. Let's fucking get them.
And I was like, boom, jackpot. I link Mist. You know, well, I message him. I would love to show you like, the messages. It's funny in the DMs, like, all the way from the start to even today. And it's like, he links me, and I got this beat sitting there. And it's for another artist, but he's been sleeping on the beat for about 6 months. I'm finding it hard to make a beat for Mist because it's just, we've just met each other, so I'm still getting to know him. I'm more like a person. When I go in the studio, I like to know everything about you. So that then we look like we've got an energy, and then that energy's turned into an MP3. I find this beat, I'm like, last resort, I think I got this beat. And that's the Carlisle's Back beat I made. It ain't got the vocals, the famous girl vocals in the back of Carlisle's Back at this moment. So while that's going on, Zeph, producer Zeph's in my house, and he's showing me how to chop vocals on a thing called Fruity Slicer. So I incorporate what he's taught me on there, and then I'm like working with this singer called Rafaela, and I just think, whoa, why don't we just put vocals behind it or something? And I use that technique and then put it behind Carlisle's Back on the chorus and the verse. The song's just sitting there. I fly out to Miami. Whilst I'm away, Mist is recording it with Savak, finishing off the verses and stuff. They get the song done or whatever. It gets mixed or whatever. I'm like, cool, yeah, great, sounding sick. And then it comes out while I'm in Miami. And it just blows up. And then by the time I come back, it's been about 2 weeks, and Carlisle's Back has blown up on Link Up TV. Everyone's singing it. It's crazy. And I'm like, out. Like, I'm even whilst I was in America, I was like, I was just coming out of this depressive state. Like, I was just like back into like who I wanna be. And it was gonna work this time because my Steel Banglez tag was on Carlisle's Back. My logo was in the video. And I made sure all the things that people stopped me from achieving or doing, I made sure I did it with the new batch of people that I was working, because they had that respect for me and they wanted to see me win. It wasn't just about themselves. We built a family over that studio in my house. You know what I'm trying to say? Carlisle's Back comes out, it goes crazy. And I'm under pressure because, like, people think Mist's a one-hit wonder or whatever. The Asian language, obviously, Carlisle's Back is smashing it. My Instagram starts popping up and I'm like getting popular again. Everyone's kind of getting to know Steel Banglez. I don't have the other tags at the moment, just that. And that Steel Banglez tag is getting played on radio everywhere in cars. I'm driving everywhere, I'm hearing this song everywhere. I'm like, fuck, I've done it. Like, it's my biggest song to date and it's taken me about 6-7 years, but I'm here. I didn't give up, I carried on, no matter what. Depression, no depression. Recession, no recession. You get me? So I'll just keep going. Mist is in the studio. He's trying to make this tune. I hear the beat and I'm just like, blood, stop that beat. Like, I'm under pressure. I remember this. Carlisle's Back is killing it. And I remember thinking, what am I gonna do next? And the night before, I've been listening to Beer Garage tune. Because obviously I grew up on Garage. Because whilst I was like, coming out of this depression, I always did things that would make me happy as a child. That's like one of the things I was taught.
So I was like watching all the old cartoons. It was weird. I was going through some mad thing, eating the foods I would eat as a kid, just trying to make myself happy again and like heal myself. It was mad. So I'm like watching Super Ted. I'm mixing garage. I'm phoning my older brother V. I'm like, V, let me come around and DJ. I ain't got decks at the time. Let me just mix. And I'm just at his house for 4 hours and he's thinking, what's up? And I'm just mixing bare old school garage. I'm just trying to make myself happy again. So I'm doing all of that. And I'm like telling my mum, make that. Remember you used to make me that? Can you make me that food? Or like when you go shopping, can you get me that? And I'm just like, there is no therapist that's healing me but myself. Do you know what I'm trying to say? And my friends, my support mechanism. And the music and the excitement with Mo Stack and Miss, and I'm just going through this crazy fucking period in my life, blood. It's mad when I look back at it now. I think I'm still 10% depressed. I think it's never gonna go away. But so I'm going through all this thing, and then I'm playing garage, and I'm like, what am I gonna do for Mist? And then I come across this bass line, which is it's an organ bass line, which is so famous in garage. And I'm watching this interview by DJ Mustard, and he breaks down how he made.
What up, it's your boy DJ Mustard, and I'm finna walk you through how I made Show Me.
Baby, yeah.
He uses this dance song, but he slows down the melody of the dance song and puts it into that Mustard sound. So now Mustard's killing it at this time. So I watched that, and I'm like, rah. That's nuts. And then Miss needs a banger, and I'm like, well, I'm gonna use the organ bass, and I'm gonna do it like garage music, and I'm gonna use house and garage vocals in the back of the chorus. So I remember that session. I remember Miss is like trying to make a beat or whatever, and I'm just like, you lot, turn that off. I went to the toilet. I'm like, God, just please give me the power to make this banger. Yeah, I swear to God, it's a true story. I'm just like, look, man, I need another one. I can't let Miss go to another producer. Like, it's like, blood. I need this one. Like, yeah, I have to secure this one, Lord. Like. I need this relationship. This has to be a Dre and 50 or Eminem or old Drake and 40. Like, I need this one, you know? Not again, like, don't let them come to my kitchen and leave, you know? So I'm like, blood. I remember going into the bathroom and I come into the studio. I'm just like, move out the way. And I'm just in this mode and I'm just went, ain't the same. So it's dun, 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 dun. Everyone's like, yo. And I'm like, what? The vocals going crazy. Mr's like, we ain't the same. We ain't. And I was like, yeah, yeah, yeah. And it's just going mad, and I'm just like, boom, ain't the same here. We're gonna shoot the video in Dubai. We're gonna change the game. And it's just like, it's just happening mad. Like, it's just like nuts. Like, I can't even believe it. Like, and I'm just thinking, whoa, Mrs., we've got some angels. Like, my, I don't know how this is happening. Like,
Steel Banglez, 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 Banglez.
Ah. And then Gov comes into the picture, who's my manager now. He's more like my business partner, but he's my manager as well. And then they come up with this crazy idea and they shoot the video in Dubai. Ain't the Same comes out. It's a wrap. 2016 has been splattered. Carla's back. Ain't the Same. My name's buzzing again. All the people that I used to work with that kind of doing their thing, whatever, producers, rappers, whatever, start thinking, fuck, Banglez is... It starts coming back. I start getting the follows back again. Oh, Bangs, what's... Nah, Kazi. Like, chill. You get me? So I start, all that happens, and then Mo Stack's blowing up, La La is dropping. Come towards the end of that year, Rashid comes to the studio. And I phoned Rashid, and I was like, Rashid, I'm thinking, how do I get bigger now? The Steel Banglez tag is out there. My logo's out there. How am I gonna get bigger? What do I need to do? And I'm like, yo, I'm gonna do the breaking and the making of Carla's Back and Ain't the Same. Let me show the people how I made the beat. So he comes to do that. I don't know how it happened. Mo Stack turns up and Miss turns up to the studio. It was just meant to be me and Rashid just recording the breaking down of the beats, innit? So Mo Stack and Miss turn up randomly. And then Rashid was like, after he's filming me break down Carla's Back and Ain't the Same, he's like, oh, you can't make a song in 30 minutes. And I'm like, bloody, you mad? Like, you know who this is? Like, you crazy. So I done the 30 minute thing. So the Carla's Back and Ain't the Same thing doesn't even come out. It's still archived till today. And Mist and Mo, it's like a challenge for us. He gassed us, innit? So he starts like, go on, make a song in 30 minutes. Not even a beat, sorry, a song. So, you know, just starts recording and stuff and like, bro, I just made this beat in 30 minutes, like in 10 minutes, 15. Mo's like a Mr. writing. They've gone into the booth, vocal the song. That gets uploaded to LinkUp right before the end of the year. And it's just icing on the cake. It makes me become bigger. It's a spotlight on me for the first time. As a producer, Banglez, like, they've seen the logo, they've heard the name, but this is the first time I am allowed to conduct my video. You know what I'm trying to say? And the new fans that don't know about my old work with Cash or Fixed Dotem or Crept and Conan or Wiley, who don't know anything about me, I'm a brand new guy to these people. You know what I'm saying? Banglez is the guy that come with Mo and Mist. That's what they know me as. They don't know all this extensive work until now. So I start getting out there, my Twitter starts ringing up. I'm getting bare things. You're a sick producer. Raw, 30-minute challenge, Banglez killed it. Crazy, crazy. And it starts blowing up from there. And Mist's tour's about to happen in December. First tour, I think it was. Yeah, first tour. And we've just sold out a fucking tour around the country over Carlisle's back. And ain't the same. I couldn't believe it. We're selling at 2,000 plus venues and we're on tour. I'm just like, yo, this is crazy. I've gone in from one essence of doing all this mad work and being madly depressed and like hating my life to like just being thrown on tour with having the biggest record in the country to like everything. And I'm just embracing everything. And then we go on tour. And just before the Manchester date, me and Mist made Madness at like 4 a.m. because then the pressure comes again. Ain't the same, been out for about 2 months. What am I gonna do? I've made like a rap, road rap song. I've done like a happy one. Now he needs a pain one about his mum, because he's always talking about his mum, and that's what kind of got missed out there. I just started playing piano, and then Madness gets made. He loves it. He writes a song. We fall asleep, wake up, record the song. We go on tour. Go on tour. One day after the tour, we shoot the video, and then I link Zef and Savak, and we mix the tune at Savak's studio. Zef mixes it, and then we're having issues with this like vocals and that, because it's like done in his yard. It was all mad. Even getting that tune done was just mad. So that's 2016 with Mr. Mo Stack and me now branding myself as a producer. And yeah, it just starts, people start recognizing me. I'm like tired one night, and Savak and Zef Ellis are in the studio, producer Zef. So I'm just like, fuck this, I'm going to sleep, I'm done. And then these lot, I wake up, these lot have made a banger. So I hear the beat, and then I just change that one bass line and add a string on the hook to put my little stamp, because I'm like, I need to get on Mo's project, like, this is my way in. Like, so I add like a string on the chorus and then change one note of the bass line, and then Screw and Bruise done. That was my cut on Mo Stack's thing with Zef. So that's made, but it's not come out. We got the tour coming up for Mist in March, and we got Carlisle's Back, Ain't the Same, and Madness out. And I'm sitting in the house late at night, Gov's sleeping, and me and Mist are here again, fighting each other for another song. Like, oh fuck. And then Hot Property gets made that night. And then like, I'm switching through sounds, and then I'm just doing like, when I was at 14, I used to play this melody on the keyboard where I'd hold A and I'll just use all the rest of the notes. And then I start playing Hot Property. Played that sound, Mist goes crazy. He starts playing something at the top of the keyboard, I'm playing at the bottom. Hot Property gets made, and we knew we were onto another one, and we're like, blood. Hot Property, but we're gonna go and shoot it in Iceland, because man's so hot, gotta go and cool him down. We shoot the video in Iceland. We have like, I think it's Mist's birthday, and we're all having dinner, and we're all discussing ideas of where to shoot the video. Zef's like, I've done Carmageddon in Iceland. That's a great place. And I was like, boom, yeah. Hot Property drops. I've just sorted my single out, Money. So I've got Abracadabra on there, Hailey, Mo and Mist. They've done the song for me. I'm trying to get it signed. Zion comes through from Polydor, secures the bag, boom, I give him the tune, he gives me the money for the video, and I drop Money, and now I'm established. Now Steel Banglez is here. This is what he does. He's a producer, but he also puts out his songs. But if you really know, I put out songs from time ago as Steel Banglez featuring, from time ago. But I'm still doing it, but now I've finally got a chance, and I'm around a group of people that actually support my shit, that actually are, you know, appreciate my talent and shit, understand my vision, and it's not just a selfish thing. I drop Money and it just pops, man. I get playlisted on One Extra. The video gets a million views in a week, you know, on my own channel. I've started my channel now. I start getting a look in, boom, 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 boom. We drop Hot Property. It goes crazy. The video's mad. Obviously, we won a mobile for it. I win Best Producer, GRM in 2017. I win Best Producer for Link Up TV. I dropped No Words with Dave and Mo Stack. That session was crazy. I'm working on Mr.'s Diamond in the Dirt project. It just started, then it just started happening, bruv. And then I dropped Bad last year as well, 2017, which producer Zef produced majority of. I just had my input on it. That was the second Steel Banglez featuring single with Notes, Young and Mo Stack and Mr. Easy. And I just thought I wanted to put something different on it. But most that came through every time, man, for my singles. And yeah, and like now we're here. And then you got these little short things I do on my Instagram about how I produce certain beats. Or you hear Banglez on the rhythm, yes, fucked. Or Steel Banglez on radio or whatever. And basically whatever I try to or manifest is now manifested.
in the correct way when it was meant to be. So it weren't for me at that time when I was trying to do it. Maybe it wasn't the right energy, maybe it wasn't a longer, maybe it wasn't forever at that time. Maybe it was too early, maybe the fans weren't ready to understand what a producer does or whatever. Maybe now we're more viral or more active on social medias and stuff and more realistic in terms of what people are interested in. So I just believe now's my time, and then this is Steel Banglez. This is where I am today. I don't really have a typical day. You know, a lot of creative people, we're crazy, innit? We're a bit nuts. I might wake up with something else on my mind or whatever, but that's why you have management or whatever, who kind of take care of my diary and put in stuff and my label now that I'm signed at Warner Brothers, which I didn't mention in the last one. I'm signed to Warner Brothers. I got my publishing deal at Warner Chappell. I got the first UK rap label at Warner Brothers called Gifted. And, you know, I'm working on that. I'm signing new artists and developing them how I've done for the most of my career in studios, but now I have legal rights to like put everything in action, in a sense. A typical day is like me checking up at what's going on at Warner, what my management are doing, checking my calendar and whatever on the work side of thing. But I hate to think as it's work. I just always like to just do things creatively and let them flow. So like I'd make a beat or try to. Sometimes I don't even make a beat for like 2 weeks. I'm just vibing in life, and then the first thing I do when I go to make a beat is a banger. Sometimes I hate producing every day because it does my head in, just because my brain's fried. I think I'm out of ideas, so I like to live life a bit and stuff and just like wander around. So I'm at that point in my life where I'm just like dealing with my singles, you know, linking. Producer Zeph is someone that's very close to me, has been very close to me, so he's like my motivator and I'm around him a lot. And I've got a relationship with Zeus from Tape. Hef's here in the studio. We're here in Tape London, where I'm here like once a week, twice a week. If I'm not here, I'm at the lodge. Trying to eat good, but some days I don't eat good. And trying to stay away from girls as much as I can. If you can take yourself right to the edge of the cliff and you're about and 1 foot off and you're holding on, and that's financially, mentally, anyone, even the family. If you can take everyone to the edge or anything to the edge with you and you still believe that you can do it, then you made it. But if you're the type of person that doesn't have the balls, blood, that's all this is about. Do you have the balls? Are you ready to put them on a chopping board and the knife might or might not? Do you understand? That's what I learned about being Steel Banglez and an entrepreneur and my dreams and everything. Do you have the balls and can you risk it all? Are you ready to die for this? And that's the kind of mentality I have. You get me? And that was installed in me through Sikhism, through being a warrior. I come from a warrior background. Do you know what I'm saying? So that's all it was, man. Not giving up and fucking putting my balls on the line, blood. The song that best describes my work ethic is No Words by Dave featuring Mo Stack, because I remember I was like going for this production thing because I was like sick and tired of doing the vocal things, like, you know, like the Carlisle's backs, they ain't the same. And I was getting like, not that I pay much attention to the fans, but I was getting like, oh, your beats sound the same, man. And like, I'm like, yeah, all right, watch. And then I made No Words. And I realized, because I felt like no one in the industry was making clever choices. I'm a type of person, I like to make clever choices. So it was finding the balance of having a soulful sound, but then still incorporating that garage bassline that I talked about earlier, which is still in that song, which no one spoke about. And having vocals, but they're just being at the end of the song instead of the whole song. And having a drum pattern, and whatever it was that I did, it was very new to everyone. Because when I played it to everyone, the people were unsure about what kind of beat I just made. And I was like, I'm telling you, I know what I've just made. Like this, you don't need to do this song. So obviously Dave done the song, No Words. Most that jumped on it, and it's just like my biggest record of my career until today. That came from being different and always being unique and trying different things and not copying anyone, and then being an innovator.
I don't want a dead no, I don't want a sorted, I don't wanna.
If you have a passion for something and if you love something so much, work ethic doesn't even exist. You're just doing what you love and you're doing it religiously. Loving music was my work ethic. Being inspired, being around it, whether if I was producing or if I wasn't producing or if I was at a video shoot or if I was at someone else's studio session, that's still work ethic. That's still studying, that's still working, because you're still taking something from somewhere and it's gonna inspire you, whether it's subconsciously or consciously. You don't know how it's gonna hit you. So just being in music every day is what I'll suggest for anyone to do. Whether it's in the studio or on your laptop or you're watching someone on YouTube or I don't know, you're going out but walking, watching the guy playing a guitar for 10 minutes at Oxford Street, I don't know.
But studying your craft and continuously being lost in what you want to do is so important, because that's how you grow. That's how you find your identity, because you learn all aspects of that, not just production. That's why certain producers just become producers and just may not ever progress in having 2 to 3 hit records, because they're just not rounded enough. You know what I'm trying to say? So that's where it comes from. So I think growing, knowing yourself is so important. Knowing your mind, how it talks to you, how you talk back to it, understanding what it is, understanding gut feeling to conscious feeling, all these things are so important to make you a super producer or super artist. The kind of child I was in the classroom, the guy that banged on the tables, played Indian drums on the tables before the teacher started the lesson, that was me. Or like doing weird noises and stuff, so I'm just a nutter. And I was always shy to answer questions, but I was always a bit popular. I'd wear a coat and I'd see certain men come in after and they'd wear that coat, or I'd do a little ting, creps ting, and it was definitely that time. I remember I started wearing contact lenses first, and then I see everyone in break time by the end of the week. I'm just looking at everyone and everyone's eyes colours have changed. It's like, what's going on here? So I was kind of like, my energy was great. I just think being bright, and then I used to DJ at lunchtime. So that kind of made me popular, like at lunchtimes in the music room. Everyone would come and spit bars and all that, and I'd DJ like. And I'm still the same, bro. I'm still gassed when I hear music. I'm still like excited. My body's grown. I'm still a kid, just a smart kid. To get to my position, I don't have a position. My position's never positioned. So it's like whatever steps you want to get to in life, you have to practice and you have to study and you have to be able to take the good times and the bad times. Majority of the people, when they're about to become something, they bail out at the bad times because they can't handle it. This is what it does. This is what the world does to you. It gives you good times and you're like living, and then it will give you the most maddest times that you've never had, just after you had the most highest times of your life. Like the highest times of your life, straight after it will give you the lowest times. If you can survive that lowest time, just know you're shooting straight past even the ever highest times you ever had. So that's what it is. It's having the heart and studying and not giving up and putting your money where it needs to be put and not on stupid things. Just praying and having faith. It gets you wherever you want to be. Your position is made. It's just my position. I didn't follow a certain structure. It's just what I wanted to be. I wanted to be Steel Banglez. That was just what I wanted to do and make great music and help UK music cross over into mainstream radio and cross over to the Atlantic. And I think I'm doing that. And that was my dream. And I wanted to have a label, and you know, I want to see others win. And I find joy in it. And I get excited when I see other people smile because I was a part of their success. That makes me happy. That comes from my mum. That's what I'm like. That's what I wanted to do. So to be like that, you just got to work hard and just be nice. And not have no negativity in your heart, or don't have no vicious intentions behind being around people and shit, or just trying to use people or learn something from someone and F them off like that. I'm not into none of that. I knew that my music was good. So if I didn't have Jay-Z at the time, or if I didn't have a Mist or a Mo Stack or anything at the time, whoever was with me at the time, I gave them my best beat. You know why? Because I knew my beat was gonna bang anyway. So if it got onto SBTV and it got onto Link Up TV, somewhere someone's gonna hear that shit, do you understand? And it might be my best beat, but I don't give a fuck. Not to discredit the artist, but I needed to get my music out there. I ain't got time for waiting for what, bro? Who waits in this world? That's like waiting for a perfect train to say, I'm waiting for a mixed race girl, curly hair and jeans. And when I see her on the train, that's the train I'm gonna get on. Nah, Kazi, I'm gone. You get me? There ain't no time for none of that. So people saying that they don't have no clientele, or people saying, or producers saying that they don't have clientele or Jay-Z or whatever to work with. My technique was, I had my own studio. I never charged anyone studio time. I made beats. I let people vocal their other beats for free. And if they were done and I was allowed to play one of my beats, I played them some of my beats. And if they vocaled them, they vocaled them. So the best thing I can say to a producer is have your own setup, which is not expensive now, and invite people to that studio of the current artists that are popping up. Don't try and reach for Drake, which is not, I'm not saying don't, but I'm saying it'll be kind of wiser for you to, because you're coming up, come up with people that are coming up, and then you grow and you create something, and then you create a family. Having a team is important at the start of your career, and it isn't important, because if you ain't strong enough to go and find your own P at the start, this is what I'm talking about, or if you ain't strong enough to accept something from your brethren, there's no point, blood. Because what happens is you get lazy. You didn't work for that $4,000 that's been spent on that project for you. So you don't know the value of that $4,000. So you don't work as hard as you would have if it was your dough.
So having a team at the start is good and it's not good in many aspects, depending what the team's doing for you. I think just having a vision and a dream and just, because what this is energy. So just having the great energy and putting it out into the universe, it's going to find the same antenna that links to that person over there, and you're just going to meet anyway. So I just think having great energy is important. My moment of wonder was when I saw Punjabi MC release a banger tune with the Knight Rider sample of Busta Rhymes' song Turn It Up with Jay-Z. I never really saw another Asian brother on TV or had saw an Asian person really get that sort of success. And he was a producer that I listened to before I got into like grime and garage and all that stuff, which I was still listening to like Asian music. So seeing him go crossover and win MTV Awards, and he has like, it's statistically the biggest, one of the biggest selling singles of all time. It's right next to Cliff Richard and stuff. 13 to 15 million singles of that song, and it's in another language, and it's in the language that I come from. That's when I realized, fuck this, anyone can do it. And then I just went absolutely hamza with it, and that's it. So that was my moment. That and listening to Dr. Dre, The Chronic, 2001. Fear is a crazy thing. I still get stage fright. I know I've done so many shows last year, 20,000 people, 35,000 people, 5,000 people. I still got fear in me, but it's a good fear. So I've kind of turned fear into a motivator. So when the fear comes, I'm like, yeah, okay, cool. Let's get ready, you know what I mean? So I think turning fear into a motivation after understanding what fear was for so long has been my greatest gift, because it's like a pump for me. So like when I'm about to go stage or when I'm about to go in the studio with someone new, fear side of it is like a motivator. It's like I'm gonna show you what's good now. The biggest misconception of this game is when you get to successful and people start getting to know your name, people think that it comes easy after that. But you have to work 3 to 4 times harder to maintain your success. So expect worse mental conditions if you don't keep yourself well. Expect friends to fall out with you and get jealous. A lot of your friends, even people that you worked with, will get jealous of you, that are right close to you, that used to be right next to your chair, and that have taken inspiration from you, or you've shown them, bring them to your mum's house and shit. They're the time for people that will still turn on you and try and run off and do their thing, you get me? And not respect the movement and try and become just like you. Expect that. Expect money to change people around you. Because I'm a nice guy, this is me though, this is going for me, this is not for everyone, because I'm a nice guy and I pay for everything and I always have done, whether I had money or not. Well, I do it. I do some way in some form to make sure my people are cool. I think once you show that level of like finance, people, because when you get to the next level, people start thinking, ah, oh, fuck it, Banglez is great anyway, it's light. Because it's only £600, like, bro, £600, mate, I come from fucking, you know what I'm saying? I come from nothing, so like, that is money, and people asking you for money all the time because you get famous and you've got so much love and bonds with people and you can't really say no. I'm the type of person, I find it hard to say no. But I've started saying no and I've started putting a tap on all of that. You become more lonely, I think. And the girls that you wanted to get with before you was who you wanted to become with now are all DMing you and you don't even like them anymore because you think it's just a fucked up world that you live in, that you had to become Steel Banglez and get in Foot Locker and be on Radio 1 with no words and fucking do a breakdown on Instagram of how we make beats with producer Zeph for these women to look at me and now kind of take me into consideration, like, yo, this guy's kind of like, you might find it hard to find a real woman. That's why I've been single from the start anyway. The great thing about it is you have financial stability to buy more stuff that you can do to help your craft. You can help your parents retire, travel the world a bit, take the stress off your friends, pay some of your friends' bills off, or help your cousins or whatever the fuck it is. Certain things, so it's just a ticket, but yeah, that's it, man. And expect for a lot of jealousy to come from other people in the industry that who was fucking with you, and now that you're successful, wanna always message you like you forgot about me, or I can't get a beat, and expect threatening messages and stupid shit and wild shit from people that you don't even know who you are. It's times 10, man. It's just time, just expect it to be times 10. And then I've got to come and put on a brave face for everyone that really supports me. So that's it. Some I have bad days, some I have good days. That's it. The special quote that I'll always live by is my brethren. He was from Ghana. His name is Sadiq Sakatni. And when I came out of prison, he gave me a book. And the name of the book was Your Mind is a Magnet. And ever since I read that book, I felt like I found a formula of understanding the universe and how to attract things into existence. And it still works to today. And like everything I ask for, it just happens. But it doesn't come in the form that I ask for it in. I have to spot it coming to me for what I ask for. So yeah, your mind is a magnet is one of the most deepest quotes for me. So what you attract, or what you think is what you attract, negative, positive, or average, whatever the fuck it is. My name's Steel Banglez, and you've just seen the wonders that got me here today. Honey! Big up Danny, yeah, you done no blood.